Today, my talk is I will try to explain Go in a C++ developer's perspective. So hopefully, if you guys, I maybe have a quick round here. I mean, whoever has C++ experience before. Oh, C is still fine. Yeah. Yes. Okay. So I was told that C Golang is actually a better C. So that's something I think I want to compare, make a comparison between C++ and a Go language. And so like as Pravin said before, Go C and C, right, has a 32 keywords. So it's something like if you are a new programmers, you need to remember all the keywords, like the type and the external and private and public. But when you switch to Golang, I mean you reduce the number of keywords is to only 20, maybe 25 or something. I don't know how many is it. 25. So it embraces simplicity. And within the limited keywords, you have to do everything. So it forces you to know that actually what is each particular keywords can do on the use case. So let me start with the syntax. So in Golang, every variable, we start with variable, VAR. So you can do like integer, characters, string, or anything. But anything, when you want to initialize a variable, you have to declare it like explicitly. Or you can do an assignment with using the semicolon and the equal statement. So you can do a comparison. Like if you have a C++ code and have a Go code, then your Go code always looks a bit more, I feel it's like my personal opinion is like more organized, because everything we start with var and you can group them into a group of variables. So actually you can go, oh sorry, how do I ask? So can I? Sorry, I need to restart my computer. Okay, so like back to the presentations. So yeah. So here's Isaac's GitHub on productions reports on GitHub on like example of how a programming goes. So here is actually a main dot goes, which is like the starting point of the program. So when you have all this library and you declare all the variables, you can see that all the variables actually shot this quite nicely. And after this, you can, I think one of the nice thing about Golang is that you don't need to care about the semicolon. So it's something, I have the feeling that Python, because in Python, you just declare the definitions. And it's like you, the compiler, when you run it and you compile it. I mean, in the backgrounds, C and Golang compiler, we automatically add the semicolons for you. So that's why you cannot like in any statement, for example, if else, you cannot do put the curly bracket into in a separate line. So if you make the function broken. So
it doesn't do any look ahead check?
You can do a look by using the range keyword. So like when you have a map.
I mean the bracket. If the compiler do a look ahead check if there is a bracket in the next line.
You mean this one?
No, it's just now you mentioned that the bracket cannot be.
So I mean that I cannot put the whole things in the separate line. So I cannot bring up this line to up and have to write after the conditions. I have to write open bracket immediately. So it's kind of like general rules. I mean initially I don't like it, but somehow like now I get used to it. So.
But how about the? Okay, you come back. Yeah, there are bracket in the new line 53.
This one is more like a closure, so it makes sure that like, everything we happens in the closure, we're not going out. So like the variable I define in the closure, and Golang force everything. If you especially you define and you initialize. And you assign the value in the closure, then it only works in the closures. If you use a variable outside without saying anything, then you maybe encounter the shadowing errors. So the compiler, when you run the program, it tell you you have a shadowing variable, and you have to fix the problem. Okay, so let's try these programs. Okay, so here's a list of all the operators. So you can see like the order will be a bit different from C and C++. So the same statement in C may give a different result. But I mean when you combine a different sequence, for example, you have a number. Let me try this one. Okay, what do you think is the possible result? Oh, by the way, I have a prize, so if you answer correctly, then you get the prize. Yes.
If you play from 1 to 10.
1 to 10.
No. If you play 1, 1, 1, 1, 1.
Okay, how many number 1? Okay, any other solutions, or do you want to try? What do you say?
I is very two times implemented.
Then what is the output?
Should be 1, 3, 5, 4, 5, 6.
So it's a 1, you mean all the odd number from 1 to 10?
Yeah.
So okay. Okay, let me try the run.
2, 4, 6. Eight.
You say a 2, 4, 6? Okay, let's try the run. Sorry. I cannot give prize to anyone. Because if you see something like plus plus one is a post, no, sorry, is a prefix statement operator. In Golang, it didn't allow to you to use. So if you write postfix is fine, but prefix is not allowed. Even you use it in on expressions. For example, I want to use e plus plus, and I want to multiply by itself. Then the compiler will tell you, I shouldn't use postfix statement inside expressions. So I need to to make it a separate line. So I mean, it's a lot of gotcha for me because and the reason is maybe you guys can. The reason is Golang want to force developers to use so one function you need to break down to many steps or many lines, so it's easier to read. So I think it's very opinionated, because even in other language, for example, Scala, you can actually write a lot of functional language, but Golang is in opposite way. It forces you to do something simpler first. So yeah. Okay, so this operators. If you in C, right, you can overwrite. We have overloading operators. In Golang, it didn't allow you to do that. I think maybe Java doesn't have the operator loading, operator overloading. So let me. Okay, pointer. You like pointers? Do you like C more, Java more? Just tell me the truth. So in C, right, you have a pointer. I mean, you can pass in either by pointer or by value. In Java, most of the function, most of the case is passing by a reference. So reference is like you reference to the address of the object. So what happened in Golang is it still uses the concept of pointer. So I mean I think most of the case still is exactly like C++, C and C++. But I mean behind the scenes, Golang we run is on a garbage collector. So it makes sure that if we try to optimize and allocate the new assigned variable to the heap of the memory, so everything when the functions return, you actually you don't need to care about, oh, I need to delete or like free the variable, the memory you already allocate at the beginning. So I mean you get the benefit of Java, because Java actually you is a auto garbage collector language. So Golang also do that behind the scene. So yeah, maybe I try this one, try this example. Okay, so this question, okay, are you, how about this one? Do you think this program, we have any errors on what it is? Okay, so Marshall and Marshall is like it's like encoding and a decoding in JSON. So we have a byte stream, and you want to grab it as a data structure. So you want to decode it as a data structure and later encode it again. So you can see at the beginning you have use a JSON encoding JSON, which is a package in Golang. So actually you can find the docs online. For them, I have this one. So after you install Golang, right, you can check the manual on the terminals, and you know that, oh, the encode and the master and the unmaster is here. So you can try to look up for the function implementations. So the good thing about Golang, I feel like I really love it, is that everything is be explained to you in detail. So it forces you, okay, you have to explain everything in comments at the beginning of the functions. Okay, so back to the questions. I mean, do you have any idea of what's the output of this one? Sorry. Compatible. Okay, let's try it. Yeah. Okay, so as a C++ developers, I think obviously I declare the animal is a pointer. So I get the address. I am sure it, I mean to the address of a new pointer. So it should be the program should be throw some errors. Because in C++ or in C, technically you cannot like get the address of a new pointers. But in Golang, it's possible. So yeah, thank you for grabbing.
I have a question.
Yes.
The JSON commercial line, if you remove an ampersand in the arguments,
okay. So you want to know that, okay, what is inside the, what is argument, the type of the argument in the function?
Because we declared animal as a pointer to animal struct, right?
Yes.
And I'm just wondering, the ampersand represents is
the address.
Yeah, the address, right? So you're sending the address. Isn't animal already in?
The animal is not a pointer. The animal is a struct, so it's a type. It's actually is similar to struct in C and C++. I think C++. Yeah. So.
Yeah, but animal points to the struct.
Animal is actually a struct.
It's a struct. Not
yeah.
A point. But
I mean the variable animal.
Oh, the variable animal. The variable animal is actually a pointer.
Yeah, but in the JSON commercial.
Yes.
So could I remove the ampersand instead?
Yes. I can try. But I think it won't work.
Yeah.
So it says that, oh, I think you are, if you want to know why, maybe you need to, you should try to get the explanation. Oh, sorry, is this? I'm not sure. Can you see from the back? So explain that you have to pass an interface. Okay, so I mean the, your interface must be one of these values, so it can armature the string object to become to return to the address of the struct. Yeah, so okay, I give you this one as a homework. You can yeah. Anyway, moving to the next questions. Mm-hmm. So here's a non-interface type. Okay, so can you see from the back? Okay, this using a sync package and using the mutex. Okay, the question is, what is the final value of this value? If I run the program, then what is the final value of this variable? Two, right? Yeah. How about you? It's not correct. Can you? Error, right?
Error.
And why?
One.
Actually, can you tell me error on which line, so
14.
It's easier to...
15.
15, okay, which...
I don't think you can lock.
22.
22?
Error of line 9. 9. No, that's not 9. Can you try another number? I mean, maybe you don't know which line is it, you say a random number.
It's from
7. Very safe, yeah. Sorry?
18.
18? No, it's not. Sorry? 14? Yeah, let's try to run. Okay, so I'll give you a price. Okay, so the explanation is you have to realize that why, I mean, at the beginning, like I use a type alias to sync the text. So in Golang, if you do, for example, you have a type int, and you declare a new type, it's my integer. So all the methods of the integer, actually, it's not copy over to your new defined structure, as a new defined type. So if I use this one, I remove this one. One. Yeah, well now it works. Yeah, so please notice that because sometimes I mean you have a lot of predefined struct in your program, but when you copy over to a new or you redefine it, you have to there's a technical the okay command patterns. So you have to like convert the type to the original one. So can you use the original method? I mean, it's a bit confusing for me, but it's kind of like the difference between Golang and C. Okay, so Okay, over OP. So just now I asked, do you think this is GoLang is a object oriented programming? Then do you think it is or
it's not? I read it's not.
Okay, so I think
from the Java developer, so I don't know if it's same perspective.
I think I believe C++ and Java is very strong object oriented because you can define class and you can define object. Each class, an object, you can define a different layer of private and public, or like you can define, I don't know, maybe C++ has a friend or a friend class or like a protected class. So only those directly inherited class can use. So I mean, GoLang, it tries to achieve the same same goal, but using a different terminology. So for example, encapsulations, I have I use this. Usually for GoLang, you can use IntelliJ. So you can use Java, both Java and C++. GoLang projects are the same. So okay, so for example, you can see this class. So in C++, you have to define private, then you release all the functions. Oh, okay. Okay, can you see from the back? So here's a class. So we have to define a private, and we have to define a public functions. So what happened in GoLang? Okay, so I make a example over here. So the way GoLang define is actually a type. So also is a class. Class and the method is equal to type and the method set. So the private method, you just use lowercase. So you can see the name, right? From the name, you instantly know that, oh, this one is a private method of ARRU, which is a receiver object. And the public method is actually smaller. You have to camera case, the first letter. I mean, it's more like a convention. So yeah, I never see that in C++. So inheritance. So instead using like for example, in Java, you use like implement. You try to implement a parent class or something. In GoLang, you try to bring the compositions concept. It means like you try to composite your class or your type with to satisfy all the methods of the parent class. Okay, let me give you an example. So this have a interface subscriber and have this method. So the method here is kind of like a very poor abstract class type. Has no implementation at all. So the interface is just like you declare the signature of the functions. And in the composite class or composite type, you just implement it. So this one returns something. And then you know that this compositions is preferred over inheritance. So I mean, it's try to achieve the same goal.
How do you relate that from the first screen that you showed?
So I mean, this example I have only one. Yeah, so it's a type interface. You have only one signature functions. So it's like abstract. It's is that a signature of the functions? And in the inherited type fixed subscriber, you try to implement it. So that's why if you want to do a shot, very simple example, you want to shot some integer. I mean, if you have already have integer, it's fine. But for example, you have a string, and now you want to implement yourself. So you just do implement the three functions of the shot interface, which is like my length and my by comparison or something. So instantly, I mean, the composition pattern is like, it don't tell you you actually inherit from the parent class. But we give you the flexibility to be inherit from a different class or object. So I think it's more like, it's very open-ended. Because Golang's core developers want to force you to do in their way. It's not your preferred way, so. For abstractions, I think that's one thing you can imagine. Okay, so how do you like you want to implement? You feel that, oh, if you use composition all the time, so every time you declare a new derived class, you have to implement all the functions. So it's really time consuming, and you write a lot of code. You just return something, and you don't save any time for other things. So the solution is use type embedding. So it means that, I mean, it's a Golang way of implementing things. So let me have an example here. This one. Okay, so yeah, I mean, you can define, for example, I have last update time is actually a difference, I mean, an existing struct. So assume that this one is some struct. Oh, sorry. Can be a struct or some interface. So in the new struct, I just call it last update time. So instantly, the error you cache, we have all the method of last update time. So it's how I mean Golang want to get the abstractions works, which using the field is embed type. I mean, if you don't use embed type, then this one you have to define as something like maybe struct something, maybe or time dot time something. But I mean, if you use embed, then actually you can define a hierarchy of your class. It's really like one way to get things done. So okay, before going to error handling, maybe I want to try a simple example. Okay. Okay, so this is another question again. What is the output of this program? Are you sure? This This is C++, sorry. This is
C++.
Oh, sorry. I have to input, right? As soon as I run this program, and I input number one, then what is the result? Okay, let me try to run. Oh, now just ignore the warning. C++11, I didn't run the flag, so for them, I run number one. So why is 6?
There is no place.
Okay. Okay, good explanation. Okay, now I do the same thing in Golang. Now what do you think the result? One right, why?
One by one.
Okay, the reason is it's a Go language. Who say 6 just now?
I said 6.
Okay, everyone, you get one. So if you still don't know what happens, it's the way Golang forces you to. Actually, if you realize that my first flag, Golang want to make you free. Remember that you have to type break every time you using a switch case. I mean, it's just simple like that. So. If you don't know, I mean, you still complain, and maybe you just go to their FAQ. Where is it, FAQ? Yeah, frequently asked questions, and they will answer you. I mean, why you need to use? Why there's no question mark? I mean, the short forms of an operator, or why they need they. They use they prefer using postfix over prefix. I mean, it explains everything here. So, okay, let's go back to the presentations. So, yeah, due to the time constraints, so it's OP. I mean, it's actually more complex than that. I brief it in one slide. I think the good thing about the error handling, I mean, C++, I need to use. I mean, every time if you have a problem, you have to throw exceptions, right? But in Golang, the error actually is the first treated entity. It's like one thing difference. Like you can define your errors, and you can make it like as a return. Usually, you can return a result on the errors together. So you actually you can check the errors and know what happens. So. It's really different from a lot of language I'm using. If you something, for example, you get a new pointer, you declare a new pointer and you pass it a function and it's got panic, right? And the whole function will crash. And the whole program we stop. That's why the panic part is sometimes it's annoying, but actually it forces you to use as a Golang philosophy. They want you to do something error proven. If you have something wrong, that you should be responsible to fix it, or you have to return it as a new error. You have to check everything to make sure that you know what happens in your program and your microservice. So that's why I mean it's an advantage of microservice compared to monolith. Okay, the last slide. I really love the concurrency of GoLens. Because as the C purpose, I think you can use. I remember there's some threat libraries. And let me try to go. For example. Yeah, it has some library. I mean, from the standard package to for you to define thread, multi-thread in the program. But C++, I mean, is really heavy. Really heavy sub-process in the operating system. So compared to Go, like it's more lightweight, and actually you can spawn as many as you want thread or routines, and you can run it in your programs. So now let's come with the last quiz. I hope you can get the prize. Okay, so now the question is, how do you fix the errors? Okay, I run first for you to know where the errors come from. Okay, so this one is like you are trying to implement concurrencies, multi-thread programs. Using a sync package to simulate, you spawn different Go routines. So you see something like Go functions. It's actually a Go routine. So this one will be run in the background. So the error is all the Go routine are sleeping. Goes deadlocked. Why? Silence. You mean the main thread is a main function?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's quite close, but it's not there yet. Okay, so what do you know that is what is the done channel do? What is the role of this one? So I mean, it's kind of like you simulate different worker. So you can imagine the do it is actually a background worker process, and you have to have a monitor. It's kind of like you tell, okay, done already. Then the channel we actually you can see over here when the channel receives the value. So then, this is an unbuffered channel with actually empty value. So struct curly bracket means empty value. And when it's each process when it's running, and when I call the close the channel, then everything close. So it's like you run a monitor and you tell every all workers stop. So if you think something or yes, then how to fix it? You want to leave? Okay. I can try. Okay, so it means that even I defer, right? Then even you cannot done because like it wait. I mean maybe it's somewhere it's stuck.
The closest after wait should be after wait.
Okay, let's try.
Stop it.
Okay, so you can imagine like if you try to move the statement, you can see the difference, right? So maybe for that, you can terminate the workers because you see it print out something is done. But now you move the line behind, and it didn't print out the last line, means the channel didn't trigger. I mean this line didn't trigger. So it must be something wrong with, the worker group. It wait. I mean, it waits there forever. So I mean, it's stuck on this line number 18 throughout the program. Okay, so let me try to do something more. Because I use a shortcut function, right? I must do it a shortcut function. So now I try to copy it back to see what happens. Okay, so now I try to run it. Okay, still not working. So you think, which one? Oh yes, yeah, sorry. Okay, so the problem is still there. So, let me tell you the solutions. When you pass a variable to a goroutines, then it's better to pass the address of the variable because WG is a weight group. And when you pass to goroutine functions, if you pass the by value only, then actually you pass a copy of the object or the struct. So when you call the function here, actually this WG is another instance of a weight group. So yeah, let me try to pass the address. Oh, okay. So okay. I will give the price to myself. Okay, so yeah, it's the last quiz for today. So I just want to share the philosophy of Golang is, what Golang developers, the team, the core team want to achieve is they want to communicate. They don't want the programming process to communicate by sharing the memory, but we share the memory by using the communicating. So it means that's right. Every process should be deterministic. So you know the sequence should be well defined. You have a channel. This channel we receive, and that the other channel we send. So you can declare your functions. And if this one has the send channel, another one has the receive channel. So you know that which one will happen first. And the flow will be like clear. So it's how you don't use the shared memory, which is like you store the state or like you store the flow in some common memory. But rather than that, you use a channel more often to achieve the same goal. So I hope you. You can learn a lot from Golang. It only has very limited keywords, but it's more complicated than what it can be seen. So hope you like it, and if you have any questions about the quiz, you can talk to me later. Thanks. So, is there any shout out about job posting or?